This is the Literary License Podcast with your hosts, Vicky Ray, John Wilson, and Keith Shorgo, discussing book to screen and everything in between, coming at you from the UK and USA.
They keep it real.
Japanese submarine slammed two torpedoes into our side, Chief. He was coming back from the island of Tinian to Lady, just delivered the bomb, the Hiroshima bomb. 1,100 men went into the water. Vessel went down in 12 minutes. Didn't see the first shark for about half an hour. Tiger, 13-footer. You know that when you're in the water, Chief? You tell by looking from the dorsal to the tail. Chief, the sharks come cruising. So we formed ourselves into tight groups. You know, it's kind of like old squares in a battle, like you see in a calendar, like the Battle of Waterloo, and the idea was, shark comes to the nearest man, that man, he start pounding and hollering and screaming. Sometimes the shark would go away. Sometimes he wouldn't go away. Sometimes that shark comes right in you, right into your eyes. Thing about a shark is lifeless eyes, black eyes, like a doll's eyes. High-pitched screaming. The ocean turns red. And in spite of all the pounding and the hollering, they all come in and they rip you to pieces. You know, by the end of that first dawn, lost 100 men. I don't know how many sharks. Maybe 1,000. I don't know how many men. They average 6 an hour. Thursday morning, Chief, I bumped into a friend of mine, Herbie Robinson from Cleveland. Baseball player, bosun's mate. I thought he was asleep. Reached over to wake him up. Bobbed up and down in the water. It was like a kind of top. Upended. Well, he'd been bitten in half below the waist.
Hello, welcome to the Literary License Podcast. Today we'll be discussing Jaws, written by Peter Benchley, and the film directed by Steven Spielberg. And today we have our normal co-host, Victoria Ray, or Vicky Ray, as she likes to be called. Say hello,
no, Vicky. Whatever. Hi, guys.
And John Wilson.
What's up, guys?
And today we have a special guest co-host, John Hunt, who's the author of the novel The Tracker, which is out now, and Dollhouse, which came out earlier in the year. I say hello, John.
Hello, everyone.
And today, before we get started on Jaws in our month of Born with Teeth, what we would like to do, I thought we'd raise a question about what sea mammal or fish would each of our co-hosts would like to be reincarnated as? And starting with Vicky, what fish, which you already are, or what sea mammal would you like to be?
What seen them all. Okay. Well, I probably want to be an intelligent one, probably a dolphin, because they can actually defend themselves against sharks and whatnot because they got their long proboscis there. And they just are really cool.
And if you swim with a dolphin, they actually come in your face, apparently, when you swim with them.
I heard about that. I haven't tried that yet. That's on the menu.
And what about yourself, John Hunt? Which sea mammal or fish would you like to be reincarnated as?
Well, I was inspired by the movie The Other Guys. You ever see that one with Wahlberg?
Oh, yes.
Yeah, so the tuna. Because the tuna could take out that lion that Wahlberg was saying would come out, swim out into the ocean to take care of the tuna. And he goes, my tuna buddies would kick your ass. So I like
But you might end up in a can, so that might not be a good thing.
That's true. Sorry, Charlie.
I didn't from that movie, I didn't know that tuna can grow as big as they do, right?
So it's huge.
Yeah, no, they're very big. They're humongous. And John Wilson, what fish or mammal would you like to be reincarnated as?
I would probably be an octopus because I think that they are flexible and bendable and they love to hug and squeeze things and they can camouflage themselves. So that's pretty cool.
And they're mighty tasty.
Yeah.
and when you get excited, you can over ink yourself.
Yeah, exactly.
With you today and inking and face shots and everything else.
It's gonna be one summer. Of the I'm getting the summer friskiness. Well, what fish or mammal I would like to come back as? I guess I would like to come back as a mermaid because of my love for Ariel and something about wearing a seashell bra, but I guess it's going to be realistic.
Those are pasties. That's not even a bra. They're like clinging onto that shit. Okay.
But I'd probably like to come back as a killer whale. I think they're quite sleek. I quite like the whole black thing and, you know, the little bit of white. So I keep, you know, my former goth being in my new fish.
And it's politically correct.
Yeah, just stay away from San Diego.
Yeah.
And Japanese people.
Yeah.
I read something about
the border of our audience.
I read something about killer whales there. It's they're talking about how trying to determine how intelligent they are.
Mm-hmm.
And there was a reported case of a killer whale holding a great white shark still long enough for it to drown. And then it ate the shark's liver, so only the liver, so the scent in the water would drive all the great white sharks out of the area. So the killer whale.
I heard about that.
Wow.
Oh, God.
Well, they're incredibly strong and social animals. I mean, not that we saw any killer whales where we went last month, but they're so social and such fantastic creatures. And they were pushing their babies up to the boat, you know, to us. Yeah. I mean, those just whales are just fantastic animals.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
What I found interesting is that how did this killer whale know that holding the shark still would drown it?
No kidding. Yeah. Good question.
Yeah.
You know, talk about instinct.
Yeah.
Quite like whales. I'm glad they're quite protected, only because they used to use them for dog food. They used to kill them for dog food back in the 60s and 70s, didn't they?
Yeah, the blubber, right?
Well, the people in Baja told us, the older fishermen that took us out on the boats for the whales told us they used to call them the killer fish because they used to see a boat come out and they said they would just come in there and sink just about every fishing boat. And then when whaling stopped, they started getting social again to where they bring their babies up to the boat and stuff. They're not like that. It's like they know. Mm-hmm. And they bring their babies back every year. It's really weird. They're just fantastic animals.
Mm-hmm.
So that brings us to forming the plot. So John, would you like to give us some brief reason why we're covering Jaws this month of May?
It is that time of year again where summer is on its way and the waves are high along with the teens drinking on the beach whom exercise their rites of debauchery. I mean, what could go wrong if, say, you jump into the middle of the surf, riding the waves in the ocean as dusk approaches? Bum, 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 bum. A killer story, that's what could happen. And did happen. Jaws was written by Peter Benchley and was published in 1974. It was born out of his interest for shark attacks after he learned about the exploits of shark fisherman Frank Mundus. The film, produced by Richard Zanuk, bought the film rights and selected Steven Spielberg to direct the film. There was some controversy over who was writing the screenplay, since Zanuck was promised this, but Benchley, however, was conflicted with Spielberg with the vision of what he wanted for the film. So after turning about three drafts out of the screenplay, Carl Gottlieb was... Gottlieb was brought in, which resulted in both of them getting the bench credits for the screen creds. I have to admit that I'm not scared of much, having conquered a lot of my fears, but the one fear that kind of lingers with me is jumping into large bodies of water.
No kidding.
And that contributes to a couple of things. So one is Friday the 13th, Jason Voorhees. The other is Jaws. So seeing this as a kid, it just definitely spiked my fear for what lies below the surface of things. What about you guys? What do you...
Well, if you remember correctly, like Keith, I don't know, Keith, if you remember back, because you're a little younger than us, John, but it caused a panic. The movie and the book, people did not want to go swimming. They were scared to swim in Lake Ontario, for crying out loud. It really scared people. I mean, made people license to pause. Should I jump in the water? Or, you know, I mean, it was just a total PTSD mind shock thing for people. I mean, people were actually kind of afraid to go in the ocean.
Yeah.
I mean, the thing about Jaws, Peter Benchley, this is pretty much his carry. He was a failed writer. He tried writing this. I mean, he did have a nonfiction book about his travels when he was younger that was picked up by a publisher, but it got to the point, this was his make or break. If he was he had to write one more novel. If it didn't take, this was going to be it for him. And so he went to the publishing company. He gave him two suggestions, and one was Jaws. And of course, Jaws is what set him on his way. The interesting thing about Peter Benchley, though, he did write all the sequels for Jaws as well. So I would think that looking at the sequels of Jaws and seeing this Jaws, I would sit there and say that the other screenwriter probably had a bigger hand in this production of Jaws than the previous ones, because the other ones are quite weak.
Yeah.
Really.
Yeah.
But, oh my God, you think?
But I think but I mean, if you look at Peter Benchley's other side of work, you know, the Island, the Beast, I mean, he pretty much stuck to the sea theme throughout his career. Yeah. But the interesting thing about him really is that in later years, because of Jaws, Jaws created a hunted animal, or fish in this case, and they're almost extinct because of the movie Jaws and the way Hollywood's portrayed them, to the point that they're almost to the point where they're actually going to have to start being protected.
Yes.
And then you also have like shark fin cuisine, basically, where they cut the top fin off the shark in Japan and China because it's, you know,
the delicacy.
It's a delicacy, and it also promotes male potence, whatever.
Right.
And what they do is they cut the top fin off the shark, and then they let the shark back into the water. So they're not even using the whole shark, and that's killing a lot of them at the moment.
Yeah.
And, you know, so I think with this, Peter Benchley, later on before he died, actually looked at this, and he became an ocean ecologist, and he actually started funding to help save which his wife is doing to this very day. So it's quite interesting how he's done a 180 turnaround. It made the most frightening thing in the ocean now the most sacred, needed to be protected thing in the ocean.
The years ago when I was young and I used to go to spend, like 1982, I remember, I was 17 and I used to go to Wildwood, New Jersey, go to, you know what I'm talking about, probably, John, down by Ocean City and Seaside and all that. I spent summers down there, and the delicacy in 82 was shark heart. People were serving that up like crazy.
Yeah.
They go out and fish for it, bring it in.
We think of jewelry too, shark tooth and all that stuff. Like, people are making jewelry out of it. And
well, David Cassidy, I think, made it into a fashion icon back in 72 or 73.
Yes.
Yeah.
The shark tooth.
The shark tooth jewelry and the feathered hair.
Oh, yes, he did it for. He had perfectly feathered hair. Now, y'all be hating on the hair. Y'all were jealous. You know you were.
I'm definitely am now.
holy mackerel.
So for no further ado, what we're going to do is a synopsis of the book, which I'm going to do myself. Jaws is basically a book that's told in three parts. First part, People go swimming, shark attacks. Second part, wife gets horny, gets nostalgic for life, has an affair. Townspeople are worried about losing their businesses due to their jobs only being summer jobs. Third, wife has regrets, decides to carry on with her marriage. Meanwhile, the guy she has an affair with, an old fisherman, and the sheriff go and hunt for Jaws to disastrous results. That's pretty much the synopsis to cut it down in a nice little nutshell.
Right.
So to carry on forward to our page to page segment, John Hunt, what did you think about the book Jaws by Peter Benchley?
I enjoyed it for what it was, right? I think it was a showcase of the shark. When he wrote parts about the shark, it was very suspenseful. It was very interesting. You saw the ocean the way the shark did, and how it was a mindless but very effective, very, very evolutionary perfected eating machine. And I enjoyed those segments of it very much. And I liked Brody as part of the working class hero type of mentality, and the problems with the economy, and but I think I liked how they streamlined the subplots in the movie, right? So we talk about Ellen Brody in the book. She wasn't very likable. She got into a marriage. It wasn't what she thought it would be, even though when you're reading it, Brody presented it exactly what the marriage would be. His aspiration was to be the chief of Amity.
Yeah.
So she knew going into it that this is what my life is going to be. And
dissatisfied woman she was,
Yeah.
Ungrateful, basically. Yeah.
So she knew what she's getting into, essentially. And she was from an affluent lifestyle. And I don't know why she thought sheriffs were affluent. But she got into this lifestyle, and then she found herself isolated from her friends in the way they were, right? Because they're New York socialites. They went to parties. They didn't really care about money. Wasn't really a factor for them. They didn't have to worry about what food was on special. So then she lost what was essentially a commonality with her past.
The shirt with the alligator.
Yeah. Big fish in a big pond versus like big fish in a small fish.
Well, they mentioned that several times, the shirt with the alligator. What was those called?
Izods.
I think they went out of business, didn't they? Anyway.
I think Polo took over for them, really, didn't they? It went from alligator to the Polo shirt.
Or isn't an alligator Lacoste, right? Or no?
No, you're right. It is Lacoste. You're right. It is Lacoste.
Yeah, but they were called Izods in the preppy stages.
Okay.
The alligator on the shirt became a huge thing, and about between 1980 to 83, when the preppy look came forward.
Yeah.
And then I think they were always Lacrosse, but somehow they got the name Izod. I'm not quite sure where Izod came through, but
I remember them being worn in college. I never wore them, but
well, they're expensive.
Yeah.
I just didn't like them.
They had made a good point in the book. You're paying a lot of money just for that alligator on the shirt, right?
Yeah.
The logo. Exactly.
And I mean, the people I knew that wore them, they're dicks, really.
They wore those. Yes, they were.
Those duck shoes.
I'm going to go to the country club and I'm going to play tennis.
Oh, Muffy.
She kept talking about that the whole time, about getting the boys to play tennis. He's a sheriff. Now, how the hell is he supposed to afford tennis lessons, like John was saying?
I mean, I'm gonna throw in a contradiction of Ellen. I mean, Ellen's an interesting character in herself. I think that she comes from, as you say, an affluent social background. I think she fell in love. And I think the trouble with Ellen basically is that she's living in a small town. And unfortunately, small town mentality, they do not accept outsiders whatsoever. And if you're in a summer community town where you have a bunch of influential people, sprouting down into this town year after year, the townspeople look at them as outsiders, but they're making us money. So, we're basically, they're not a part of us. They think that they're better than us, but we're going to feed off them, pretty much like right. sharks feeding yeah. off them of the water. And I think that, you know, Ellen then gets married, and I think she's quite happy she seems to be quite fine until, you know, her ex-boyfriend's younger brother appears in town, which is the character Cooper. And I think at that, it seems that that point, that's when her world all of a sudden goes, I think anything that was subconsciously that she kind of regretted about any decisions she made came to the fore. And, you know, I think with Ellen, I think when she did marry, and with all the best intention, I thought that she said that, you know, Mary, I'm in love. I can give up all this nice stuff, but then what I'll do is I'll make a life with my new husband, Brody, and I'll become part of the community, and they'll fit me, they'll love me because I'm marrying the thing, everything's going to be fine. And in the summer, I can see my old friends. But then, as you know, when it comes to high school or college, as you get older and your friends start having children, lives separate. And
they do.
What you once have in common is no longer there.
Yeah.
And I do think, I mean, you do see a lot of people who went to college or high school looking back and trying to form friendships, either via Facebook or Twitter or wherever nowadays, trying to grasp that bygone life, because once they get into adulthood,
recapture.
They realize adulthood is not as idealistic as they think so in their teens or early 20s.
Exactly.
Yeah. I mean, saying that, I mean, she is very plotting. I mean, you know, she FDS'd herself into a stupor just to have her one night of sex with...
Afternoon on a rainy day.
Yes, but she dabbed every single orifice that she had with a bit of perfume.
Even
surprised she wasn't stinging.
Even her feet. She FDS'd her feet. Mm-hmm.
But, I mean, Jaws generally is a very interesting novel. I mean, the thing is, it's you have the bit about the shark, but in all honesty, the shark is not a really major part of the book really at all.
It's not. Especially in part two. Part two, he's like, where's the shark? I forgot. I hadn't read the book in so long. So,
well, it's more about this community. And you got to remember, the book came out in 1974. Just before 1974, there was the energy crisis in 1973, right. Which basically, I guess, is about the time that the book is written. And at that time, the 70s wasn't a good time in America as far as economic goes. And, I mean, there was the gas prices, gas lines, money was hard, a lot of unemployment at that time. And I think that Benchley really captures the small-town mentality against this social and monetary construct that he concluded. And I find that the book, which is quite interesting, when, if you take the shark out of the book, the most interesting thing is the townspeople and how they all react.
Right.
And, but another thing that also is, it's almost like Peyton Place. This book, which is basically, this book is a soap opera, and everyone has a deep, dark secret, no matter what it is, outside of Brody, who is, you know, what you see is what you get with Brody, but meanwhile, everyone else has this weird little secret behind them.
Like Larry Vaughn, he had the partners, you know, and you never really, you kind of figured out who the partners was, but, you know.
The mob, his deal, his shady deals, which is interesting, because I feel like with this, it's like, the shark is sort of the ancillary monster, because the monsters are people's mentalities, that things, what you'd be willing to do to keep your businesses afloat, what you'd be doing to keep your home or your social, you know, outreach sort of yourself, like what would you sacrifice in order to keep your holdings and what you have, or what would you sacrifice to have a bang, apparently, you know, with Ellen there, you know?
Well, it was basically basic human selfishness, you know?
Yeah.
Was what it was about. And I mean, the shark was just, you know, the catalyst.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, to what everybody would do.
Absolutely. So the problems were always there, right?
Right.
They always depended upon the summer people coming in and throwing their influx of money, right? So they always depended on that. So it was the shark that brought it to the forefront, though. It's like, this is now panic time, because if we allow this news to get out, this could really adversely affect our entire year. So it brought all that stuff, brought everyone's selfish or maybe bad parts of them forward, because, you know, and when they're talking about the mayor, Larry Vaughn, outside of the shark, like, they had a good relationship with them, right? So Brody had a good relationship with them. Yeah, he invited they went up to dinner with the wife and they did all that stuff together. It was, you know, they enjoyed each other's company actually. Right. So, but it wasn't until the shark came out where the mayor was like, you know, well, you're not closing the beach or we're going to take your job type thing. Right. So,
yeah.
It was only, you know, when there was trouble that the rest of these guys, their actual bad characters came out.
Yeah.
It cracks me up, the Larry, not to get to the movie first, but the Larry Vaughn in the movie as opposed to the Larry Vaughn in the book.
Yeah.
It's just like, talk about, you know, you're charlatan and, you know, and, you know, shifty kind of person. Even look shifty. It's like that. Don't say anything about that nobody. No one's going to miss that girl.
I mean, the book is very, very interesting the way it plots out each of the minor characters. And I think Benchley does a really good job of taking characters who might only have two or three paragraphs, but actually being able to flesh them out quite well. I mean, you can pretty much see all these, you know, minor characters coming to the fore. And I also found it interesting that he sets, normally what you read about a small town, and a small town's about caring and knowing your neighbors and loving each other. You know, that's normally what you get in a kind of
novelization
of any kind of a small town.
Provided you're part of that small town though, right?
Yeah, exactly.
But in this, I mean, even in the beginning, the shark attacks, and it seems like the community is not all that caring. They don't really care about the victims. They're all looking about themselves. It's all about themselves, which is quite an interesting influx of what you find normally in this kind of a tale, whether it's horror, science fiction, or regular fiction dealing with small towns. It's always like something bad happens, and the whole town's, you know, up in shock, and they kind of pull together. Here, the town doesn't pull together. Something bad happens. They all think about themselves and just pull apart.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, I mean,
for each themselves.
Yeah.
But I mean, you know, the thing is, at first, when I first started reading it, it's like, okay, well, fair enough. You know, they're outsiders, are getting killed by the sharks. You have the hippie girl who goes out for a swim. You know, she becomes, you know, food. The little boy out on the raft, I'm assuming that he's not a local because it, you know, seems like, you know, they're one of the out of towners, no big problem. But then when it comes to Ben Chambers, is it? And then he dies, and it's almost like, okay, the wife, you know, as you know, the wife's attacked, but the town's not really affected by one of their own even being munched by a shark at all. They just seem
I agree.
The fisherman Ben Gardner, right?
Like, oh, Ben Gardner, that's
he was sent out. He was sent out to kill the shark, right? He went on his own.
Look, yeah,
and he didn't do it, right? So they're kind of. I think in that point they were kind of like the whole town was in a pause moment, right? Well, now what?
Right? Yeah,
we still need the rich people's money. Yeah. One of our own's dead, and he didn't kill he didn't solve our problem for us. And not a lot of people stepped up to try to solve that problem. They're kind of closing ranks, right? How can I save my own house? How can I save my own business? What am I going to do now?
Right. They didn't have no problem going and sending the doctor to drug Mrs. Gardner because she was hysterical either. I guess that's what they did back then.
Yeah.
You're like, sleep forever.
Yeah, get some sleep. Oh, yeah, your husband just got eaten by a megalodon.
Well, in England, it'd be like, just have a cup of tea. Your family's been mowed down by a city bus. Just have a cup of tea. Okay. But, I mean, Jaws is, it's a very interesting book. I mean, the thing is that, you know, there's a spoiler alert here. People get their just results. They're just desserts in Jaws, I find. You got Hooper, who sleeps with a married woman. He becomes fish food. Quint, who's all about the money. It's not all about, you know, they change a lot for the film. But
personal with him.
It's all about the money. It's not about the community that he's part of. It's not about, you know, helping saving the community. It's about money for himself. And he will hold the town at ransom to get the money that he wants to solve his problem.
Yeah.
And then the only thing that we really do have is that, you know, the book does end on a slight cliffhanger. The simple fact is that he's pretty much put together the Ellen situation with Hooper, but you're never quite sure exactly what he's going to do with that information.
Yeah.
You know, so you don't, so, you know, even though Ellen tries to make amends, she becomes loving and everything like that because she realizes she's, you know, she's made the
right choice.
She loves her husband. I don't know if she loves her husband for the simple fact that she's too lazy to leave her husband. I mean, it is the early 70s and divorce wasn't the big thing that it would become later on.
No.
In sages. And, but, you know, she's going to love her husband. She's going to make this a go. She loves her children and this is the way she's going to go. So she tries to turn over a new leaf. Whether Brody's going to buy that or not, we're not really quite sure.
I think he was going to. I think he loved her. I just think he was kind of, you know, PO'd that she just didn't seem as interested in him sexually or socially or otherwise. But I think he loved her. And I think he was upset that he knew that her and Hooper had something going on that one Wednesday afternoon. And I think he was troubled by it because he did love his wife.
Or unless he just wanted to take her out for a midnight boat ride and just
dump her off. Give her a Mexican.
I mean, the relationship between Brody and Ellen, I mean, the thing is, Brody does love Ellen for the simple fact is that he puts himself in socially awkward situations to please her.
Yeah.
And to be honest, even that cringeworthy dinner party that she holds, and the thing is he's twigged. I think it's one of those things that if you've ever been in a relationship where you know the other person's had an affair, the thing is, there's part of you that always kind of knows, but you're never, you kind of know about it, but you're never quite sure exactly what's going on. You're doubting yourself and you have that Brody feeling going on at that point. And I think that he does twig a little bit, but you know, then he twigs later on, of course, but you know, he puts himself through this for her. You know, it's like the tennis lessons for the boys. He's like, well, they need tennis lessons for, you know, we can't afford it, da-di-da-di-da. But he still considers it because this is what would make his wife happy. This might be what, you know, this is what she wants. He will move heaven to hell for her.
Yeah.
And at the same time, we're not, it seems like all Ellen knows how to do is become a housewife. She doesn't do anything to please Brody at all. I mean, she puts the, you know, she cleans the house, does the laundry, puts the meals on the table sort of thing. But she doesn't really have to go out of her way in order to keep her marriage alive, whatever. It's all have to be Brody meeting her. It's not Ellen meeting halfway. Yeah. It's Brody meeting all the way.
Yeah. Yeah.
But I don't know if this has to do with, you know, her coming from an influential family. She doesn't say anything about having brothers or sisters. She might be an only child. If she's an only child, she's probably used to getting everything her own way and everything she wants anyway.
She did seem a little spoiled, you know, as far as his child, almost childlike for a grown woman,
if you think about it, it's a little Green Acres for her, right? So she went from a posh life to this sort of small hometown sort of living. And though she tries to adjust, you can take the girl out of the, what's the saying? You can take you can take the girl out of the city, but you can't take the city out of the girl. You know, it's for her, it's like, it's awkward. And she's trying to bring that to this small town and it's not working, you know? And you start to, I think you see through the book that she starts to have escapism. Like she's trying to escape this other life and live in this other world. And then, but there's a cause and effect. Right. So what happens when you have an affair, like, and what's, you know, you have to kind of figure out what's next and how do you move forward, you know?
Prior to that,
I think everybody, they kind of humanized her. I think everybody has questioned, you know, their relationships at one point or another.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
But I think prior to that, she was preoccupied, right? Because the kids were younger. And so they take more time and energy, right? So she didn't really have time to think about where she thought her life should be, right? So it's like, it's almost like a midlife crisis she kind of goes through.
Absolutely.
This is where I am. Am I happy here? I don't know, but I know something's wrong, right? So Vicky said it earlier where, you know, she was trying to get involved in the community, but the community wasn't really accepting her. And then her old friends who were rich weren't accepting her. Brody always accepted her, but she couldn't see that. Right, because she wanted to be part of a different group for whatever reason.
Right.
When Hooper came in the town, she saw a way to, relive her the idea of her affluent lifestyle from the past. Right, because he actually represented that. He represented the Lacoste. Right. So, and then she went for that. And then after that, she it could be possibly like she just didn't realize that how shallow it was until it actually
well occurred. That lunch she had with him in the novel, it's just like, you know, that whole conversation is like, what the hell is this? I don't know if you remember the conversation. Just like, that's not just normal lunch conversation. Even if I was going to sleep with somebody after lunch, I wouldn't discuss it at lunch on what I was going to do.
From a feminist point of view, I mean, I do have to sit there and say that she really took that feminism by the horns and just grabbed a hold of it. I mean, she was the predator.
Yeah.
I mean, the funny thing about Jaws, I guess you can sit there and say the whole book is about predators, really.
Yeah.
Predator in the relationship, Hooper being the educated predator, Quint being the predator on the sea, the townspeople being the predator of the summer people predatoring on the small community every summer to get what they want. The only person that's not a predator is Brody.
Yeah, Brody is that.
I mean, the part
he's
about
the only decent human being in the whole novel.
I mean, the thing about Ellen, I mean, I think it's just, I mean, she's not, Benchley does a really strange thing with Ellen. First of all, he doesn't make her likable. And I think most authors in this kind of circumstance would do something to make her likable, or even when she turns a new leaf by the end of the book, give it to a point where, give it a bit more. He doesn't tend to do that with Ellen. And though thinking about Ellen, and if you put it into realistic terms, I mean, you know, she is use a weird term, fish out of water in her life. The only part of her life that does make sense is her being a mother, and that's it. She doesn't fit, as you said before, she doesn't fit in her community. She doesn't fit in the community that she had. And Brody, I mean, Hooper is basically symbolizes the man that got away, the life that could have been.
Right.
You can remember, she went out with Hooper's brother before she went out with Brody. Hooper's brother could have been the husband. It could have worked that way. Of course, life, puts you through, chops and changes and has its own designation for you, but that's what could have been, and this is what is. And I think that's where Benchley kind of lets the side down with his characters in Jaws overall, because they're not very likable. There's not a likable person in this book whatsoever. Yeah.
No, there isn't. You're exactly right.
I mean, even
I found Quint very one-dimensional in the book, right? In the movie, he was amazing, but in the book, he was very, like you said, he only had one interest in mind, and there was nothing else interesting about him, right? Mm-hmm. He wanted money, and this is how he would go about getting it. He used baby dolphins to get
I
that.
Know. Right? What the hell?
Yeah. It's just like he was just not likable, right? There's no backstory there. There's nothing there to indicate why he was the way that he was. Right? Whereas, like, you know, in the movie, there was a really great reason for the reason why Quint was the way he was.
I know. I liked his character much more in the movie because the actor, as we all know, did a fantastic job. Absolutely fantastic.
Well, Benchley does this really weird thing with Quint. He foreshadows him. He does like a Dickensian foreshadow where he's kind of mentioned like taking a group of people boating. And then you don't see him at all. He doesn't, and then he just comes in at the end. And it's almost like, I don't know if he put that scene in part one to like, you better refer to him. Let's write this in really quick as a rewrite. The important thing to remember about Jaws is that when Jaws was first written, it went to the publishers and it had to be rewritten quite a few times before it was ready to come out.
Right.
And sometimes I think that maybe sometimes with rewrites, maybe there was a lot of heart at one point in the story, but I think with maybe tons of rewrites, maybe the heart was taken out of the story at some point. And if you look at what was happening in 1974 when the book came out, you know, there's a lot of interesting works of novels that were coming out around that time. You know, The Exorcist book was out in 72. You also had a lot of, John Updike, Jonathan Livingston Seagull was really popular this time. And
right.
If you read these 70 books at that time, there was always a disconnect with 70s authors for some reason. Even if you look at, you know, Stephen King in 76 would come out with, what was it, 76, I think, with Carrie. Even in Carrie, there's a disconnect between Stephen King's previous work, you know, as far as
right.
It's just kind of like there. The emotion and everything comes in later on. And you'll find that in the late 70s, early 80s, that's when all of a sudden books became a bit more emotional.
Yeah.
Or have a more of an emotional heart to them. But I'm kind of wondering if, you know, due to the rewrites, is the reason why these characters are the way they are. You know, and then if you look at Benchley, what was going through, I mean, this was his make or break novel. If this didn't take, this is it. He was not going to write another thing. He was going to have to look for a job doing something else. And so I'm kind of wondering if maybe there was this bitterness in him that might have transported onto the page.
That's interesting. Interesting to me is just that I think from reading the book, I think Benchley loved the shark. Like, he liked writing about the shark. That was his favorite character in the book. And because that one was, to me, he was the most fleshed out character, considering there were so many other characters driving the story. And secondly, what I found interesting about Benchley, because, you know, I read a little bit about the book and all that stuff after, you know, reading it again. And it was destined to be a success.
Yeah.
Before he was even published, right? So it was published in 74, but it was like Spielberg and Zanuk heard about it going to be published in 73. And then when it came out, they bought hundreds of copies and then gave them to critics and set up book clubs. Like, this type of marketing push would benefit the movie, which is why they did it. And secondly, like, I can't imagine, like, before my book's even written, Steven Spielberg saying, "Hey, I want to buy the movie rights." Like, that's winning the lottery right there, right?
Yeah.
I think that put Benchley under a lot of pressure.
Yeah.
Because he was given, because you're talking about the rewrites, and that's exactly right. He was told to rewrite a lot of stuff by, I think, the Doubleday and Congdon, I guess it was. I think his name was Congdon.
Yeah, right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so he was given a lot of stuff to rewrite by that guy, and they took out, you know, they made a lot of suggestions, obviously, right? So don't do this or do that. Like, I guess there was a scene where Ellen and Brody had, you know, the marital sex or whatever, and the guy took that out and wanted the Hooper affair in there. Like, who knows, right?
Yeah.
A lot of stuff that we kind of like, don't like that too much, might not even have been Benchley. So he had to put the pen to paper to do it, though, but it might have been someone else's suggestion to do so.
I think that whenever you're giving a contract or an advance, in this case, what was it, $1,000 advance for a book that has not yet been written, I think you've kind of written your own artistic death certificate, really, to a certain extent, because you're being paid, you're pretty much, instead of writing what you want to write, you're now a writer for hire.
Yeah.
And with that's going to come a lot of baggage when it comes to that sort of content, because what's happening is it's no longer your work. It's going to be your work against the committee, and the committee's going to win because they're paying you to write something. So it may be your idea, these may be your characters, but at the end of the day, you're being paid before it's even written. So therefore, you've already lost some artistic license just from having advance before it's written.
Yeah.
You're accountable to them. As soon as you take that money, you're accountable to them, and your ideas are accountable to them and are going to be able to be scrutinized by them. So it's different than actually having a finished product.
Well, yeah, they also, you know, have, you know, the cover art, but you can't say that didn't sell a lot of books, the cover.
Absolutely, right? That's new.
I mean, that's like probably one of the best covers ever.
Yeah.
I find also with Benchley's other stuff, this is the first only Benchley book I've read, but but he has had a very good success record of making sure he writes either half of the screenplays or some of the screenplays for all his movie adaptations.
Adaptations.
There we go. I'll get the word out. Adaptations.
Adaptation.
And I've seen The Island, and The Island, you know, I didn't read the book. The movie suffers. There's some problems with the movie, but there is a human heart story in the story of The Island. The Deep, there's also this couple, you know, there's a heart in that, and there seems to be a lot of heart and stuff in his later works. outside mm-hmm. of Jaws. Well, the funny thing about Jaws, with the sterile way that it is written, it would be the best-selling novel that he's ever written.
Right.
Yeah.
Which is kind of strange, because if you think of that, another stuff that he did write, you know, and he did go, you know, more eco-friendly with his other works later on. Beast is about an octopus. You know, he still kept that sea theme, as we discussed further. But he did have more heart in him, but they, for some reason, they didn't really hit the vein that Jaws did with its no heart whatsoever.
Yeah.
I think John was right, though. I think he liked the shark. I think the shark was definitely his favorite character, because the shark didn't seem, even though he was eating people, the shark didn't seem like near the asshole the rest of the town was.
Yeah.
Well, the thing about the shark, I mean, the shark is not a being that's actually, you know, he's not forced by emotion. He's not played by where he is in a social political setting.
Yeah, he's not malevolent. Yeah.
Yeah, well, but he's not even that. He's basically just a wild animal who's just eating to survive. That's it. That's what they, you know. And the problems I always have with sharks, I mean, with Jaws, not sharks, but Jaws or any of these kind of, you know, television films or books that deal with animals and against humans. The thing is it's always the humans approaching on their territory. It's never the animal or the thing, you know, approaching on the human territory.
Yeah.
And, you know, in the way, if you look at God's design or however, the, you know, evolution or however you want to put it, I mean, man kind of deserves to get what he gets. If you're going to approach on a wild animal's territory and that animal's going to feed and kill you, you can't make this all about you. I'm sorry, but you're, you know, does man need to be swimming in the sea? No, not really. It's entertainment for us. It's not a way for us to survive. We don't go deep sea fishing, you know, to kill fish with our bare hands to eat, because there's, you know, that's not intended for our survive. The shark, he's just swimming around. He does what he's made to do, to feed, you know. Yeah. And I think with Benchley, I think that there is, you know, an admiration for that, you know. You know, the shark is what it is. You know, that's it. What you see is what you get. Almost like Brody, what you see is what you get.
Yeah.
You know, he's not there. He's not evil. He's just surviving.
I think it's also, too, the survival of who we are, too. And you think, again, when this was published around that time of a recession, you know, there are literally the real estate sharks, right? So if you don't succeed, we'll come in and swoop and take it from you. And so you have people who are in small towns who are really trying to survive, but it also shows that the people, how if you're not careful, you bend to be a shark yourself, right? You become someone who would do anything to keep your business. You would do anything to keep your hometown the way it is and safe. And so he kind of, you know, paints the picture of that way too, that the shark is, like you said, in its environment and trying to maintain that environment. Then you have these intrusive people who are coming into its environment, not realizing that other people are trying to do the same thing if they're trying to hold on to what they're trying to hold on to. So
I do think that Benchley did miss a point in Jaws. I mean, at this point, I mean, eco-related situations were occurring in the world. And as you know, now that, you know, the greenhouse effect is very much in effect, as you know, from what you read. You know, whether it's fake news or real news or whatever kind of news people
write,
it seems, you know, there is a desperate cause in, you know, 2017. At that time, I do think if Jaws is written today and the shark was going to sea for reasons that are quite against his habitat and the way that he acts, there probably would have been some kind of eco message in Jaws if it was written today. It would be like, you know,
true.
Man has, you know, devastated
the current.
the shift in the currents and the warm, and they would move. But, you know, of course, in 1974, that wasn't really a major concern. We're just looking for more gas to burn.
Yeah. I mean, right. I think now that's what you get out of it is Sharknado.
Oh, my God. Don't even get me going on that, because I find them, like, addictive, and I have to watch, and I don't know why. I know it sucks. I know it's total garbage. I know it's trash, but it's just like, you can't stop watching.
I've watched every single
four. And you
I spent one evening watching every Sharknado film.
I know, but I'm telling you, you get all these other actors, and they all want to be in Sharknado. You know, it's like, what the fuck is with that? But they do. I mean, I'm like, oh my god, how'd they get him in Sharknado 4 or Sharknado 3? I'm just like, it's just morbidly fascinating, I guess. That's a weird
way. Well, I mean, to get off the track of Jaws slightly, I mean, there is now a Deep Blue Sea 2. I watched that the other night.
And there's also The Meg that's coming too as well.
I'm going to go watch that totally one. That looks good. I watched 47 Meters Down the other day ago, two nights ago. Did you ever see that?
Yeah. No, I could not watch that movie. I'm sorry. Like, I just see the trailer made me cringe. Oh,
the claustrophobia cringe factor. Oh my God. You know, but and I couldn't stop watching. And this, I go, please tell me they're going to get out of this. I won't ruin it for anybody. It just came out on Netflix. But I mean, I was like, if you're claustrophobic, do not watch it. Just don't.
Don't go there.
Don't go there. It's a bad place. You need to find a happy place.
So I think what we'll do now, we'll talk about overall impressions of the book and before we move on to our commercial break. And then we're going to come back with an interview with John Hunt about his book, The Tracker, and his previous book, Dollhouse. But before we go to that, John Wilson, what are your final thoughts on the book of Jaws?
I like it. And, you know, as we get into the discussion of the film, I think that this is a very different piece from the film. I mean, it definitely focuses on the characters within that town and how there is this underlying corruption that is within each of them. And so you have what's below the surface of the water, but then you have what's below the surface of this town and how people are willing to sort of do anything to kind of live in that community. I found it interesting. I don't know if it was something that that I would say was one of my favorite books to read. I think it was interesting because you get to see the play of the characters, but the shark is very like sort of this minimal character that's in it. And I was actually surprised by that, having saw Jaws like a number of times. I thought that the shark would actually play such a more predominant character, and it was actually not as big of a character as I thought it would be.
Exactly.
What about yourself, John Hunt? What are your final thoughts about the book?
I like the book. I kind of like what you guys kept saying, and you know, keep in mind, like when it was written during also not only just an energy crisis, but it was also written during a depression. I think Peter Benchley had the mayor have a mafia background, and Harry Meadows, who was the journalist, dig in deeper into that. Like, everyone had more at stake than what they had in the movie, because I think he was just trying to explain why people would do what they were doing when they knew a simple solution would be to close the beach and wait for it to go away, right? So it's like, okay, well, these guys know the shark is killing people and they're not going to do anything about it. So I got to have a real reason for that. And so I think he added more to that for that reason. But I think, you know, considering that, it was a good book. It was very much show and not tell, which is what they tell you to do a lot in writing. But it did miss aspects of the emotion that you kind of need to be happy with the characters themselves.
And what about yourself, Vicky? What are your final thoughts on the book?
I kind of agree with with Johnny and John about that. I liked the fact that, well, I mean, watching the movie, everybody says, oh, the book's better than the movie, or the movie's better than the book. But, I mean, they both, the book just goes more into the characters, and like we were speaking up earlier, the predator factor of both human and fish. And it almost, to this point, made the shark look like the good guy. And I kind of felt bad they had to kill the shark, because everybody had an agenda. And the shark just, you know, was looking for what was on the menu that day. So, but I think mostly what Peter Benchley caught in the book was just the whole what encompass human greed and what drives humans as predators themselves, including the shark. And the shark was just like in the backlight of it. And all these people were just, you know, messed up. There's only one person in the book wasn't an asshole, and that was the cop. You know, it was Brody. Everybody else was out for themselves, and nobody cared if, you know, if somebody was killed in the water and they wanted to keep the beaches open. And, you know, there was just, it was just all about me. And I think he captured the, you know, because the movie doesn't go into the individual character and the mind of the shark as much. It's sort of like Cujo, you know, Stephen King's Cujo. You know, you kind of know what's going on in the shark's brain, sort of. You know, what, you know, how he's good. And the victims, it goes into what the victims, you know, felt. It's like, oh, shit, I'm screwed, you know. And they basically knew it before they died. But I liked it. I liked how he kind of encompassed the whole, you know, the whole town, and like, and the shark was just merely the byblow of everything else that was going on.
My personal thoughts on the book, I found it very interesting. I felt myself very emotionally detached from whilst reading it. Though it did pique my interest. There's not one point where my mind wandered off and going, oh, how much, you know, and I didn't like skim to the end and find out how many more pages I have to read. I didn't feel that way through this book. But I did find, as was previously said, that I found the shark the most interesting character. And I found the other ones, you know, not as fulfilling. And when the shark came on the pages, I found it very, very exciting. But, you know, unlike what you're mentioning with Cujo, at least Stephen King, we were inside the dog's mind in Cujo.
Yeah.
Sometimes a bit too much, you know. But, but I mean, overall, I mean, I did enjoy I enjoyed the book. I mean, I had problems with the book, and I do have problems with the film, which we'll discuss after a commercial break. But overall, I think it's an interesting book, and it did pique my interest to read like Peter Benchley's other books and just see how they see what has happened to his writing style over the years. So I probably would fish out a couple of his other books and read those. But so that's my overall thoughts and everyone's overall thoughts on the novel Jaws by Peter Benchley. What we're going to do now is go to a commercial break brought to you by IKEA, and then we'll be back with a special interview with our special guest host, John Hunt, and talk about The Tracker and Dollhouse.
Let's play a game. I will ask you yes or no questions. Ready? Do you have a rocking chair to relax on? Do you have space to store your toddler's toys if an unexpected guest came over? Can you lay down comfortably on your couch? If your answer is no to one or more of these questions, then you need the new IKEA catalog. Visit IKEA at Cairo Festival City and get your free copy. Enjoy 1,000 new ideas and more than 2,000 new lower prices. IKEA 2018 catalog. Make room for life.
IKEA. Hey, welcome back, everybody. We are going to start our interview with John Hunt, and Keith is going to start us off with that.
Hello, John. Welcome to the Literary License Podcast. And before we get started, I want to sit there and say that I've read both your books, Dollhouse and Tracker, did reviews for them, and I love Dollhouse a lot, and I like Tracker even better. So my first question is, your excellent first novel, Dollhouse, which was a dark, gritty, dark fiction thriller with its roots in horror, where did you come up with this idea for Dollhouse?
Most of my ideas just come up as just like a scene in my head, right? So for me, it just started out with the scene when the dad gets the phone call from his missing daughter. So that's just from that, the whole book came out. That's kind of how all my stories, I'll just be running or doing whatever. And you know, your brain kind of floats sometimes. So, and then something will come up like that. And then I'm like, oh, okay. And then everything else kind of falls from that, but it has to fall from that in a logical way. So then that's the only time I actually plan anything, right? It's when you're kind of write yourself into a corner and you try to write yourself out of it, right? So that happens quite a bit. And then you have to like go for another run and try to do what you can to get it loose and figure out how to get your characters back on track. But for me, it's really, really organic. Like when I first started writing, I was like looking at other people and how they did it, what their process was. And some writers will write the whole book out, like an outline for chapter by chapter and what they're going to do. And they have a whole character thing and it's all out there ready before they even start to write the novel. I can't do that. That's not how it works for me. So for me, it's just, like I said, that scene. And then I have the characters firmly in my head. And then I just do what I write what I think they would do.
How was your book Dollhouse perceived due to scenes? You had some rape and violence in there. Did you get any adverse publicity for that, considering the advent of feminism or the new form of feminism?
I really read a lot. I've read Jack Ketchum, and he's very, you know, he kind of has a niche market, right? Mm-hmm. And some of Richard Layman stuff, right? Like, I've read a lot of that stuff. And for me, I'm not really, even though I read it, I was never comfortable writing it gratuitously. So I wanted to find that fine line where I inferred it, and then the reader would take it over from there, right? So they couldn't actually go, no one could actually go into my book and say, this is exactly what happened, or this is what you wrote. But it's definitely implied, it's definitely inferred. And, you know, I got mixed reviews on that. For some people, they wouldn't say, no one actually said it was too much, which was actually, I was quite surprised at, because it was a really fine line I tried to ride there, right? It was very, very tough. But some people, strangely enough, like, you get reviews every now and again on Goodreads or whatever, mm-hmm. and they'll say something, I don't normally read horror. It's okay, so. And then they'll clarify, but, you know, I read this book, Dollhouse. It was a good thriller, but, you know, some of the implied scenes were too much for me. Right. Mm-hmm. And I get that. Like, every time you read something, it's personal and how you see it. Right. I try to write in a way so I have the reader see what I see in my head. So I just, and sometimes I'm successful and sometimes I'm not, because reading is such a personal thing.
It is.
Yeah. Before we get to the next question, I mean, to go further with Dollhouse, when I read Dollhouse, yeah, but I found that it was quite organic to the theme. It wasn't in there because it was in there to shock. It was what that character and what was going on in the situations, without giving anything away. It felt natural within its story. I know that there is this, you know, phrase is going on, which Amazon's actually going really heavy against, is the extreme violence horror books that are out at the moment, where you can tell that things are just kind of thrown in there for the sake of being thrown in there, and they're not organic to the characters. And I say in Dollhouse and in Tracker, in those instances, I felt that it was organic to the story. It wasn't in there to shock. It was part of the story. And that's what I quite enjoyed about, you know, Dollhouse and the hard themes that it does touch on, and even Tracker itself.
Well, thanks. That's what I did try with that. Like, I wanted to put a spin on it where I wanted a person where these people are trying to break her, right? Just break her in every sense of the way, like emotionally, spiritually, whatever you can, and they try to destroy her. So I went, in order to do that, I had to utilize those tools and try to get the reader to get there with the person being trapped, with Olivia. And so I wanted to be that. Like, when I write, it has to make sense. Like, if it's in there and it doesn't make sense, and you can't tie it in somewhere later on, or it's not intrinsic to what's going on at that moment, I get rid of it, which is why my books tend to be fairly short. But that, yeah, that's what I try to do anyways.
In your new novel, The Tracker, is a dark thriller, which changes focus from your previous novel, and is told through flashbacks. How did you come up with that mechanism? Because that's very fascinating.
So that one was tricky. So once again, it started as a scene in my head, right? So for that one, I wanted to show, okay, From the opening scene, Taylor walks into the police station, and you get a sense that something terrible happened, right? And from the reaction of the police officers and the reaction from Taylor, and then it goes into the interview room, and you're like, okay, well, what happened? Like, why is he here the way he is? Or, like, what's going on? So then I had to tell it that way to get to that certain point. And then once we got to that certain point, that's when you move forward again. So it's like, it kind of starts at the present, goes back in time, then back into the present again. And, but I had to do that. And because I liked the opening so much, I didn't want to change that. Right. So I thought it was very,
very interesting. So that's the hard part, right? So
right.
You read a book, you start reading the book. If you're not, if it's not interesting within the first, I give a book 50 pages normally, right?
Yeah.
So if it's not interesting in the first 50 pages, then the reader's not going to want to proceed, right? So I try to write what would be interesting to me. So I'm like, this would be interesting to me. I really like this opening scene. I'm not moving it. So how do I make this opening scene make sense? And then I had to work backwards to do that.
Yeah.
Both of your books deal with violence. What draws you to the subject?
I am a huge 80s horror fan. So I grew up on all that stuff. You know, Michael Myers, Friday the 13th, Hellraiser, and all that type of stuff. And I've always been fascinated by the unstoppable force, right? So that would be like the Jasons and the Michaels, right? So that thing has always been interesting to me because I was always fascinated by people's reactions to it. So when you watch these movies or even read the books, they're presented with this life or death situation, and they all react differently. Right. And I was really interested in that, and like, okay, well, how did this person, get the tools to survive this, and how did this person fail to survive? Right. So that stuff's always been, I think it's like an extreme situation and a human reaction to it has always been really, really interesting to me. And, I think horror for me anyways is the best tool to utilize in order to showcase that. Mm-hmm. And so I've always liked that. I guess it's like psychological aspect to it, right? Like, why, like with Olivia, like why was she so strong, right? Like what was in her life that made her the way she was? And so that, and I really liked writing about her. And then with Taylor, right? Like why was he the way that he was? And he was really interesting to write about too. So that's what it's always been. I guess I grew up very young watching Halloween and Friday the 13th. And then I've always had that fascination. And, you know, of course, Stephen King and all these other excellent authors, Graham Masterson, like all these guys, Richard Layman, like I said earlier, and they're just too many, right? Richard Matheson, amazing. All that stuff has been more fascinating to me than other genres that I've read, right? So, cause I read literary fiction, I read historical fiction, I read a bit of everything, right? But for that's always been the most fascinating to me.
It's good stuff, that's why.
Yes.
They don't do it anymore like they used to. You've had short stories published in various anthologies, such as Bright Mares, Amok, and a few others. Do you find any differences in writing your short fiction from full-length novels, and which do you prefer and why?
So for the short fiction... I mostly wrote that in order to build my name, you know. When you come into something like this, like I didn't start this until I was like late 30s, right? So when you come into something like this, it's like, okay, well, how do these other people do it? So you look up, right, and you try to figure out how they did it. So you got to figure out if you can actually do it. And the best way to do that is to send your stories out. And if someone likes them, that's great, right? It's not like, for me, like there are some really good self-published authors out there. I'm not going to say, but for me, I wanted someone else who's in the industry to say, yeah, I want your stuff. I think this is interesting. And I think I can work with this. So I wanted that type of feedback before I invested more time. Like I was always going to do it anyways, but before I invested more time, right? So I went the short story route. So the difference between short story and long fiction, short story, essentially I'll look on all the dark horror websites and be like, okay, they'll have a contest and they'll have some rules that you have to follow in order.
Right.
Right. So
yeah,
they direct, I guess, the theme of my story, right? They decide because I have to write to that theme.
Yeah.
So that's the difference with that. With my books, that's all me with my ideas, my characters, and how I want to do it. Like the other ones are my ideas and my characters, but like they'll direct a theme. Like Amok, it was like something, deal with a crazy situation. It could be supernatural otherwise or whatever. And then
yeah.
Frightmare is like flash fiction. So I was limited to 500 words, right? just stuff like that. And I kind of like that because there was a deadline involved, right? I had to have it in by a certain time. And it was somewhat structured, so I was able to streamline my thoughts and concentrate a little better. Whereas my long fiction, it's like I try to write 1,000 words a day, but you know, I have 4 kids, and you know, I have a full-time job, so I don't always get that done, right? So that's my main goal. But when I had short fiction to write, I'd be like, okay, I could punch out a story in a day or two, right? So
yeah,
and do the editing process.
So can you tell your fans and our fans what you have coming down the pipeline?
So my next project is about a man who lives off the grid. So he grows his own food. He generates his own power. He's not interested in cable or phone lines. Like there's no roads to his house. Like he can't get there by car. And he's built this place on his own. And you learn the reason why he's doing this, but you only learn a small portion of that reason at the very beginning. So as the story develops, you get to know more about him and what happens and why he's so reluctant to join the world again. But of course, you know, events force him back out into this world. And so there's a lot going on there about how he's able to adapt going back to the world after such a long time, and whether or not it's a good thing or bad thing. For him, it could be, it's a good thing for him potentially socially, but not maybe so much physically. So, or it could be the other way around. There's just a lot that you kind of uncover as it goes further along. And with of course, in the background, the general murder and mayhem that I tend to have in my books. But a good barometer for my stories is my oldest son. He's 17. So I'll have him read like maybe the first 30 to 50 pages of my book. And for this one, he was like, oh, I can't wait you to finish this. This is really, really, really interesting. And he's good. I trust him with that because he shut down the last project I was working on. I was trying to do something foolish. I was trying to do 2 projects at the same time. And so I showed him the one. And he's like, Dad, I don't know about this one. And I'm like, okay, well, why? And he told me, and it made sense. So I'm gonna have to go back and absolutely streamline or cut that one or even start all over again. My wife Louise reluctantly reads horror. She reads what I write, but she doesn't normally read horror. And she's also not afraid to pull any punches. She'll tell me, this doesn't make sense, or this is falling flat. And that's also very helpful.
I think the going off the grid theme will resonate with a lot of people, actually. I think we all dream of going off the grid and just getting the hell away from all this bullshit. Mm. And, you know, and it probably will resonate with people completely.
Really, should they say, I was looking on the internet, like, how do you go off the grid? So I was like looking at all this, you know, that's weird looking on the internet about how to go off the grid, but that's how I'd looked it up a lot. And I was like, there's really a lot involved, but it's also, if you're determined enough, it is something you can accomplish. So I was able to adapt it to my character based upon that. So
cool.
It's good.
Well, when you finish that book and it's getting ready to go publishing, make sure you let us know because I'm eager.
Yes, please.
So I want to say thank you, John Hunt, for doing our interview with us for the Literary License podcast. And thank you for joining us for Jaws. And what we're going to do now is we're going to go to another commercial break from Amazon. And then we're going to continue with the film trailer of Jaws. And then we will proceed with talking about the film Jaws, directed by Steven Spielberg.
Amazon is here to make your life easier. By just the tap of a button, you can turn the camera on your phone to your own personal shopping list. Introducing Flow. Just tap the camera icon onto the search bar, and you can find whatever it is you're looking for right on Amazon. Faster than scanning a barcode and typing the name of your item into the search engine. Besides, searching with words is so 2012. Save time and money. Amazon, where shopping meets effortless.
There is a creature alive today who has survived millions of years of evolution without change. without passion and without logic. It lives to kill. A mindless eating machine. It will attack and devour anything. It is as if God created the devil and gave him jaws. This is Universal's extraordinary motion picture version of Peter Benchley's best-selling novel, Jaws.
I just found out that a girl got killed here last week, and you knew it. You knew there was a shark out there. You knew it was dangerous, but you let people go swimming anyway.
You yell barracuda.
Everybody says,
huh?
What?
You yell shark. We've got a panic on our hands on the 4th of July.
Is it true that most people get attacked by sharks in 3 feet of water, about 10 feet from the beach?
Yeah.
What we are dealing with here is a perfect engine, an eating machine.
We're not only going to have to close the beach, we're going to have to hire somebody to kill the shark.
Bad fish. But I'll catch him and kill him.
Did you hear your father? Out of the water now!
This shark, swallow you whole.
You're gonna need a bigger boat.
That's a 20-footer.
25. 3 tons of them.
Hurry up, he's coming straight for us. Don't screw it up now.
Don't wait for me. Now! Shoot!
None of man's fantasies of evil can compare with the reality of Jaws. Roy Scheider, Robert Shaw, Richard Dreyfuss, Jaws. See it before you go swimming.
Welcome back. Now we're going to be discussing the movie Jaws, directed by Steven Spielberg. And to get this off and running, Vicky, in our lights, camera, and action section, why don't you start off by discussing the film?
Okay, let's say a comparison of book to screen on this. I would have to say that the book, well, there's going to be spoilers probably in this conversation, totally different from the movie. I really liked what they did with the screenplay and the movie because the shark really was the star of the show in the movie. And I liked what they did with the characters, like with Quint. I loved his commentary. Like, I thought the best scene for Quint in the movie was how he was talking about when they were drinking the apricot brandy and they were comparing scars. Remember, they kept showing each other their scars, you know, and he had this scar and that scar. And, you know, Quint goes into his monologue about that World War II story, the sinking of the Indianapolis, and how all the sharks came and attacked all the seamen that were stuck in the water. And I liked how that ended. I mean, I was kind of sad that Quint died because I really liked him. You know, I liked Brody. I really just thought how the characters interacted with each other, especially the three men, and that Ellen Brody wasn't such a twat waffle in the movie as she was in the book.
Yeah.
You know, she was like a strong character and a strong woman, and she had, you know, her ovaries in the right place. And as far as the ending of the book, I mean, I felt the ending of the book, Jaws, kind of left me wanting more it didn't fulfill your satisfy my, you know, curiosity as far as how Benchley ended it. And when you go into the movie, and especially towards the end, you know, instead of quit going like Captain Ahab down with a shark, you know, you did have the smile, you son of a bitch, where, you know, Brody shoots him and the tank blows up. And
yeah,
you know,
theatrical. Like
yeah, so a little more theatrics to it. And Brody, you know, gets you know, brings in his man or his shark. You know, and Quint goes out in a blaze of glory. You know, he's getting chomped on the boat and everything else. And I mean, in the book, the shark just, you know, swims up to Brody and he just dies. Yeah. You know, he just craps out right there. And that just wasn't a fulfilling enough ending for me in the book. But I know Keith's probably got something. I see him looking at me. But I mean, I know he's going to have something to say. But I just like the interaction with the characters when they're on the boat in the movie. And all that goes through with it, you know, this journey with these three men, and you know, the common cause is to get this shark.
Yeah.
And I just took it from there. Like the ending was, I loved how what Spielberg did with it. I liked how it ended. I liked, you know, it was more fulfilling this way. I didn't like it when they did part two or part three, right? Maybe part four, but you know.
Part 10.
But I really liked what they did with the ending and the interaction of the men in the story.
Yeah. I mean, it's very Moby Dick to me. I mean, obviously that's what Spielberg was kind of going for, because you have the clear villain, who the villain is in the story, versus, you know, again, the objection of the novel, where it's mostly the townspeople. This is clearly, you see, like a man or men on their mission to, you know, hunt down this beast who's killing people in the small town. So, I mean, I think it obviously works, as again, it's a clear villain, and it's the clear heroes of the story that are coming through. And I feel like that story is hard to tell again and again and again. So like you said, it kind of, you know, gets diluted down as you get to sequel after sequel. It's the baby, and now it's some, you know,
it's personal.
Now the shark's back for blood, you know. It's like, you know,
the shark knows who the family is now. Yeah. It's personal. They pass it down from
the
shark.
It's tasted its blood, so you know.
Exactly.
I mean, one thing I could say about Jaws, it has some of the most ugliest people I've ever seen gathered together in one film.
I mean, I like Brody. I know,
especially for like a summer movie where everyone should be like, very, no.
But yeah,
I mean, the girl like played Chrissy Watkins, the one that gets killed, the hippie girl. I think she wasn't even really talking about Babe-a-Rama or anything.
Well, I mean, there was a lot of hair going on in this movie. Although, I mean, it was all so dry.
Come on, everybody had that
feathered hair, you know.
Well, I'm talking about, but I mean, I think it kind of adds to the film, because I mean, I'm sure that, I mean, going through the cast list and stuff like this, I mean, some of these townspeople, I'm sure, were just extras that they pulled off this. I mean, the book itself is set in Long Island. This is set in Connecticut. Yeah. And I'm sure that they just took these Connecticut people and just used them as, you know, background. And I mean, it does show, right. But I have to sit there and say, I mean, yeah, it wasn't the most impressive looking cast, though the main actors were all very, very good actors. There's nothing wrong there, but I'm just sitting there saying it's quite weird to see. I mean, you gotta remember that Jaws is the beginning of the summer blockbuster. This is what would start off the summer blockbuster films.
Yeah.
And this is the one that started it all off and became the event film that we have every single summer now. But this is the one that started it. So it was quite interesting, and I think it's quite good at this casting and stuff like this. But I, you know, looking at today, I think to myself, like, God, isn't there not one attractive person? I mean, nowadays, I guess you're so used to seeing attractive people all the time on television and film. Yeah. It's kind of weird when you go back and look at something like, oh, my God. Obviously, they didn't, you know, contact any modeling cast agents.
I thought Roy Scheider was kind of sexy in a weird way. I mean, you know, there's something about him that was masculine and, you know.
Well, Rob Scheider is an excellent actor. The weird thing about Rob Scheider, I find, is that because he has this kind of a skeletal, you know, face, basically, he's like skin pulled over his skull. And that was sometimes you can get him confused with James Woods. He has the same thing, except James Woods
exactly.
has but he has acne scars and Rob Schrider doesn't.
Yeah.
But Rob Schrider is an excellent actor, and he, everything that he does, I mean, he makes everything very, very believable. I think, unfortunately, I do think that Robert Stack steals the movie from everybody.
You know? Yeah. I agree.
Dreyfuss is pretty new to the film industry at this point. He hasn't done Close Encounters yet. He didn't go up for his Oscar turn in Goodbye Girl yet. You know, so you know, he's very new to acting, and he looks very fresh-faced.
I liked him. I thought he was funny in Jaws, though.
Well, that's what I think. That's what they need. That was missing, which is why they hired a comedic sort of writer to come in, because they needed that comedy element to kind of lighten it up when it got too dark.
Every time they pull out the tray where he's supposed to like examine the remains, you know, the first victim, and yeah. She comes out in a little box. You know, I always think of John Belushi making fun of that on Saturday Night Live. Have you ever seen it?
No.
You have to Google it. You have to look it up where John Belushi's pretending. You know, they always back then made fun of movies. John Belushi's, you know, like, you know, looking at the tray. This was no boat attack and all of their stuff. They bring out this hairy arm and everything else. But I mean, he just kind of nailed it, you know? Mm-hmm. I loved his part in this movie, because that's what it needed. Because the book, I mean, compared to the movie, is dry.
Yeah. So, I mean, and he, and you know, the big difference too is he lives through this. So it's like one of those things where, you know, as Keith said earlier, how different would it have been is the comedic beat part of it. He dies, you know, like how much.
Oh, I know he died in the shark cage, but I mean, barely yeah. Think of the shark cage, even loading it on the boat. It's just like, what the hell is the guy thinking?
Well, that's what you kind of like in that whole scene. I forgot rewatching, going, why in the hell would he do that right now? Like, what yeah. What would go through your mind to think that's the best approach of you to go in a cage right now and fight?
No, absolutely no.
But that's what I kind of like about it, though. That's what I like about Richard Dreyfuss. You get his acting in it. You get from him the sense that he believes he knows these sharks.
Yeah.
He believes he knows what they're going to do. He knows how to deal with them.
Yeah.
You know, he brought the strychnine. He knows all this stuff, right? So, yeah. And, you know, he relies on, you can see that at that time, there's a contrast between him and Quint, right? So he relies on the new technology with the sonar and all that type of stuff, right? Whereas Quint was like, no, we're just going to chum the water and the shark's going to show up, right?
Yeah.
So there's a contrast between those two. So I like that Dreyfuss did that, because he's like, he's confident in his own opinion, and he believes that these shark cages were tested, and that it doesn't matter. He's jazzed. He's so excited to see the shark underwater, because to him, that's the biggest one he's ever seen. Or he thinks it's one of the bigger ones based upon the bites that he's seen earlier, right? So he's jazzed and he wants to go in there. And I think it added realism to his character, because you look at him and you go, okay, this guy loves this stuff. He's so excited to do this, even though it's anyone looking at it from the outside, like you or me, is like, dude, you're nuts. What are you doing, right? Yeah. Like this insane. He's eaten five. The shark's eaten five people. Like
he's big. I think he's also inquisitive at it, right? Versus Quint is a hunter. Like he wants to hunt it down and add a trophy to his wall. Cause you know, you see him boiling. The first encounter with Quint is you see him boiling the teeth in the pot, and you're just like, oh yeah, he wants to kill this thing. He's like, yeah, let's kill it.
Yeah. Did you guys ever ask yourselves during the movie though, you got Richard Dreyfuss, you know, Hooper comes out with this great boat with all the gizmos, bells and whistles. And why didn't they use that boat to help hunt the shark down? I was like, all the way through the movie, it's like, why aren't they using the oceanographic boat?
I think that had to be a Quint thing. Like, if you want my help, screw you. I'm using my boat. This is my. Yeah. I'm the man of the sea. You're the tech guy. You can come along, but you're not taking that boat.
Like, I would have took the technology. I mean, you got radar right there.
But I think what you're also dealing with it at this point also, you're dealing with old school versus new school. Yeah. And they do play on this a lot with Quint's character and Hooper, between the two of them.
Yeah.
Quint is old school. Everything's old school. And then Hooper's everything's new school. And you do have, like, I'm your elder. Older people always know more than the young people. But the young people always think they know more than the older people. So you have that going on within the film. I do think that Jaws is an overall film. I think that it plays best when you have the three main characters, Brody, Quint, and Hooper together. I do think that I'm not quite sure what Steven Spielberg was doing. I'm not sure if he was looking for a Robert Altman effect within the beginning of the film. It seems like with the beginning of the film, when you had a lot of people talking, everyone's talking, and you're just getting a lot of noise, so you're not hearing any dialogue hardly at all in the beginning of the film. So it was kind of like a bit bizarre. It reminded me of Robert Altman when, you know, Nashville and all the other films that Robert Altman was coming out with at this time. But so I always found that, like, you know, especially like when Brody's going to the town meeting and everyone's just talking, it's really hard to figure out what anyone's saying or what they're talking about, really.
No, but they're just all blah, 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 blah.
It's quite bizarre. But I think that the movie, I don't think Jaws would be the movie it would have been if they didn't have the scenes on the boats with the three main characters, because at no point in the film do you really care about anybody until the final reel, when you get the three of them together, yeah, and all of a sudden their characters come out. Because yeah, I think that if that didn't happen, this would just been a run of the mill 70s horror film. And yeah, and Jaws does look like the prototype for Halloween, Friday the 13th, and stuff like this. You get a killing in the beginning, and then then you build up your character development, and then you get the big, kill off at the end.
And when it becomes like personal, is obviously when the shark comes after, you know, Brody's son. Then it's like, okay, now we're doing something about this. Where I think it eventually was in the book, it was more like, well, I guess we have to deal with this, because otherwise our town's going to get closed down, so let's go out to sea, you know.
I think
in the book they went home every night, right?
Yeah,
so they go out through the day and then they went home, but in the movie, I like the contrast of the three different characters, right? Mm. you have the old school guy who's, and then really you don't want to know what his motivation was until they have that night and he gives a speech, right?
About the Indianapolis,
And then you have Brody, who's the moderator. He's the guy that's keeping the peace between these two guys. And then you have the young guy who thinks he knows everything, and that, you know, while he respects somewhat Quint's methods, or to a certain extent, he thinks there's better ones and that they need to be utilizing them. And he's resentful that he's not being listened to by Quint. And you also have Quint's, resentment of Hooper's obvious wealth and the technology that he has to, because at the very beginning, you know, talking about his college hands, when he's asked him to tie that rope, you know. Absolutely. That one scene, they still talk about it. Like, how old is this movie? They still talk about Robert Shaw's monologue there, right? Quint's monologue. They still talk about it. As one of the great scenes in all-time films. So, and also Steven Spielberg did a lot of things, because, you know, there's a notorious issues with the robotic shark, right? They nicknamed the shark Bruce or whatever it was, right? So a lot of times when he wanted to use it, he couldn't use it. So that's when he thought of utilizing the barrels, right, to show the shark showing up or not.
Such a smart mechanism, because again, you don't know what's underneath the surface, so it's just the insinuation of it. And when it follows them and it's behind them, that whole scene, it's so brilliant, because you don't need to see the fin. It's that whole,
you don't need the shark at all, but you know it's there.
Yep.
Right? So it's
the foreboding dark shadowing of things yet to come, you know. Yeah. Lurking.
So I think I loved it. It was great.
I mean, I think also what this actually drew forward, actually, due to the shark not working, is that movies after this point started not showing the monster until the final reel. And I think Jaws probably was like, I mean, you did get it in like a lot of 50s and 60s science fiction horror films that were coming out in the 50s, 60s. And, you know, but, you know, as far as
deep,
but they were like independent-y kind of films. But I mean, this is the first time the studio didn't like, let's put all the money there up on the screen. And it started a whole craze after that. I mean, if you look at films after Jaws, you didn't really see the monster too much, or you might get little glimpses here and there, whether you're looking at, you know, recent films such as King Kong or Godzilla or anything like that.
Right.
And I think that it did start a movement, not showing everything in one go, which, thank God, the shark didn't work. That's all I can say.
Well, like, I think it was on strike.
Yeah. But they also did, like, if you watch the progression of the movie, so at the very beginning, Chrissy Watkins is killed. You know a shark does it, but you don't see a fin. You don't see anything, right? Yeah. And then the kid and her boy is killed. You see a rollover of a fin. That's all you see, and a fountain of blood, right? And then, like, later on, when he grabs that, when his son's in the bay, and he grabs, you see a bit of the shark's mouth as it pulls him under. So you see a small progression of actually seeing the shark with each kill or with each scene, which is, I found, was very interesting. So you know the shark's there, and then he's letting you know that it's, that you're going to get the big reveal. Like, he's actually forecasting it. So I thought it was really well done, that.
Obviously, too, it's the music too, right? So the music is
John Williams.
Is what made it. Yeah, John Williams made that. You know, presence of that shark.
I think John Williams stole his ideas from Jerry Goldsmith, though, because when you hear do do do, it sounds like Planet of the Apes.
Oh, do, do, do.
It does. No kidding. Yeah, you're right.
And because I was like listening to, I was mixing the opening credits. For this podcast, which you would hear at the beginning of it. But so I was listening to it, I was like going, and at first, when I first started, I was like going, oh, am I using the wrong thing? Was this Planet of the Apes? And it's like, no. And it does remind me of Jerry Goldsmith and, like, in Jerry Goldsmith's early career. So John Williams and Jerry Goldsmith are, you know, very famous at this point as far as their composing concerns. But John Williams is always a bit more classical than Goldsmith, I found. You know, where Goldsmith would always, like, he would look for, like, weird sounds and everything, and he'd, like, you know, put things together that way. And John Williams was more...
yeah, I was a composer.
John Williams is more classically based. And so, but with Jaws, when I first heard it, I had to remind myself it was John Williams, because it didn't remind me of Goldsmith, the way he would score films. And, but, I mean, you know, hats off to John Williams. And we have a theme that, you know, is as famous as Psycho's sort of thing.
Yeah.
Well, he's kind of set the bar for, like, he had a lot of work for a lot of years, right? He did Star Wars, he did Superman, did Indiana Jones. Like, he's known for a lot of very catchy theme songs, I guess you would call it, even though they're very classical based. Like, when I write, I listen to music when I write all the time. Mm-hmm. So when his, like, and I also have the Jaws theme on there, right? So I'll have, like, Hans Zimmer, who does the new Superman Man of Steel stuff, right? So I listen to the classical as well as, you know, everything else, like rock and whatever, right? So when Jaws comes on and you got your noise canceling headphones on, like, it sounds great, right? Yeah. It's like it takes you right back to the movie. You don't even need to see the movie. That music is just, it's so a part of it, right?
It's so etched in your brain if you're a fan. It really is, because it just goes into every generation. You know, everybody, you know, can appreciate it. I don't care. There's no reboot of Jaws. It's just never going to happen. That's right. Something that cannot ever be taken
never
away.
Never say never.
No, I know, but I mean, it's going to suck.
Just open the door, because there's someone out there going, wait, that's a great idea.
I know.
They want to Jaws.
Can't do it. You just can't do it with something. I don't care how much money you got, how many.
Especially now, though, with, like, animal activists, like, it, that tone of it was, like Keith said earlier, that's the one piece that's missing from that. So I'm sure that a new person would try to add that in. You just can't. You know, it would literally, activists would tear it apart. You know, you're hunting down the poor shark. Leave it alone.
Yeah. I have to say, though, I did. I still kind of was rooting for the shark a bit. I'm sorry. Every time I watched
it,
I always root for the shark. And I have to sit there and say, when out of everyone there, the only time I felt a little bit of loss is when Robert Shaw's character Quint dies.
Because I know.
And I'm glad that he died and there wasn't much left of the film, because the film, outside of the big special effects spectacular that, you know, that we come to received from Hollywood films, I got a feeling if it was any longer after his death, I think the film would have been really flat.
I agree.
Absolutely. And it's also, you didn't need to see sort of the redemption of it, because, you know, you get the villagers are coming with their pitchforks after that boy dies. They, oh, let's kill him. You know, they're all ready and gung-ho. And so, you know, approach could have been, do they lead the thing back out to sea, you know, get something to take it back out? No, they kind of had to go out and hunt it down to get redemption for the little boy, but you didn't need to see that at the end. Like them coming back with the guts of the shark going, hey, look what we did. You know, it was just, they left it where it was, and that it just left you with the sense of what's next, what's going to happen.
I mean, what did you think about the way Spielberg and the scriptwriters made the shark like it had like some kind of conscience, like some kind of revenge conscience? Because I found it's a bit strange. It works within the context of the film. I'm glad it's not in the book, but it works in the context of the film. But thinking about it, it's a bit odd, really. All of a sudden, you know, he's, you know, a one-track killer after they get these three. Considering that, you know, I'm not sure
Well, they were hunting him down in his primal waters, though, you know.
No, I understand. Well, I understand what you mean, though. But if you're listening to Hooper at the very beginning, he says, like, he was suggesting that they close down the beaches. And why was that? If you take away his food source, it goes away.
Yeah.
Right? So they closed down the beaches, and then they went out in the boat, and then they threw blood in the water. They threw chum in the water. So now the shark only has one place to go for its food source. Okay. So
yeah, that makes more sense.
That kind of made sense to me. Why it went after them. And Jaws the Revenge, though, that made no sense, the fourth movie.
Oh, wait, you mean the mother lost her brains and she was literally gung-ho to come after the shark before it gets in the rest of her kin, her family, you know?
I don't even know why she agreed to do that movie, right? Like, she must have read the script and was like, oh, this is a good idea, is it? I don't know.
No, she needed work.
But then the first Jaws, like, they listened to Hooper, and that's how they were able to trap him, right? They're like, this is what we have to do to get him. So that kind of made sense to me. But I think with how big the ocean is, that the shark might have swam off before they even got out on the water, because they did close down the beaches fairly quickly
after,
and then they waited to get kitted up to go out together, right? But who knows?
Yeah.
I mean, I found the book, I think some of the subplots in the book were a lot more fascinating, because you don't, here I find the movie, it's all about the it's all quite surface. I mean, there's a bit of depth to the surface here, but with the main characters, but I found a lot of it, like the townspeople and all that, was all quite surface, where I have to say in the book, you do get, because you know what's going on in the town and stuff like that, it made the town a lot more interesting. Here, the town are kind of thrown in there, just as they're just there in the film outside the book.
Yeah,
and I felt sorry for the actress who's playing, you know, Brody's wife, because, I mean, I'm pretty sure what she thought's like, oh, you know, I got the part in Jaws, and before she got the script, she read the books, but, oh, this is going to be fantastic. And then when she got her part, I just imagine it'd be like, oh. Because, I mean, outside of the ugly nightdress that she's wearing in the beginning, basically it just looked like the dress
you
she was wearing.
You are so bitchy. Okay.
Well, and they took away her big scene, which is the whole dinner party, and it's basically, you know, him showing up with a bottle of wine and her, you know, it's an endearing scene, because it's the scene between the son and the father, and how the son is mimicking the dad. That's endearing, but like, they took out that whole scene for her.
Because she wasn't like that in the movie. She was a strong woman.
She's not really a strong woman. I didn't get that she was strong. She was just there. She was like, I mean, she was part of the set. I mean, she was like the table. She was just. Well, the thing is, okay, you know, if you take Ellen Brody's, if you take her character and you span it out about what her character does, she gets up out of bed. She cooks breakfast. She basically. You know, oh, you go off, honey, da 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 da. I'm gonna go take the kids to school. Go take, I'm gonna drop them off in the.
Sorry.
It's okay.
No worries, I got it myself.
And, you know, I'm gonna drop the kids off at the park or the beach or whatever like this, and that's pretty much what you get from her. And then she's like, you know, and then they're at the beach, and then you got, you know, her Brody's, because, oh, you know. And all the townspeople come up to Brody asking for stupid shit all the way through the movie. And she's like, don't worry, dear, da 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 da. And then, you know, they buy their kid a boat. She goes, oh, you know, oh, let them sit in the boat. Don't get out of that
boat
when she sees the shark. And that's it. That's all.
Yeah, they completely downsize that character. I mean, and a lot of other characters, like the mayor, they downsize that character. He just was kind of bumbly and, oh, I don't know what you should do. What do you think we should do? I can't lose. You know, it wasn't.
He was a greedy. He was a greedy, seedy looking. He was an even irritating looking character. He's that guy, the suit, you know, the polyester, just the polyester
dress. Absolutely, yeah.
Yeah. But I do think, I mean, I do think that, I mean, I don't really think, when I think of Jaws, I really don't remember the mother at all. And I mean, okay, I watched it recently. But she doesn't make an impression on me.
She's not like the woman in the book.
But I mean, Spielberg always has a bit of difficulty in his films when it deals with a nuclear family. He has really hard time shuffling both parents and children. He's quite good with one parent and children, but when it comes to a nuclear family, he always has difficulty, you know, balancing a nuclear family in his films anyway.
I think you're right. I wonder why that is. That's a good point.
Well, I believe he's from a divorced family anyway, I believe. And
so that's what he relates to, so therefore it translates.
I mean, if you look at, you know, Close Encounters or E.T. or all the other ones that he made, I mean, he's worked himself out of that funk now. But, you know, if you look at the beginning of his career,
you're right.
It's very rare that you'll see a nuclear family in his films, you know.
That's true. I never really thought of that.
And if they are there, they're kind of just there. They're not totally measured out. He'll either focus on just the kids and the parents would be somewhere in the background, but it's very rare that he, you know, shows a, you'll never see Spielberg do a family drama about, you know, a family, you know? So,
well, no, he focuses mostly on Brody, right? And what Brody is. So the family, Ellen and his children are kind of they're kind of props to show, to give the audience an idea of who Brody is and how he acts around his family, right? So they're not going to be given a larger part in the film, basically, because they are background, right? Although I did find, for me, I found, even though Ellen didn't really play a huge part in the film, I felt like she was part of Brody's moral compass. Yeah. Like when he had trouble, when he wanted to close the beach initially, and the mayor talked him out of it, he had trouble telling his wife that he didn't do the right thing. Right. So she was kind of his moral compass there. And that also was a tool used by Spielberg to illustrate, to more flesh out Brody as a character. Mm-hmm. Right. Because the thing I like about his characters is that his characters aren't perfect. Right. They do make bad decisions and they have to live with them.
Yeah, absolutely. They're flawed in that, their approach and what they're trying to do. And even though he was trying to do the right thing from the beginning, you know, he was trying to also do right by what the town and what, you know, am I overreacting in this situation? Did a girl just, you know, go out drinking in the middle of the night and this happened to her? So he has to test this sort of, well, what do I do the right thing? I think when it became his own son was close to being a victim, he said, enough is enough. Like, I need to put my foot down regardless of what they want. I have to try to do, you know, what's right, because I also don't want my family to be put in danger too.
And if you notice, like Ellen was pissed at him when.
Oh yeah, she grabbed that kid. And she was like,
yeah. Right. So once again, that helped him decide what the right thing to do. Right.
But that other poor woman, she's just like, anyone see little? Yeah. What was it, Timmy? Anyone see
the
Timmy?
Kinder boy, and a little Kinder boy.
Alex Kinder.
Oh, poor little Alex. All you saw was a floating raft. Ooh.
Kind of makes you not want to go out on a rubber raft anymore. And all that comes back is the rubber raft. You see him just flopping up in the air.
That scene, by the way, is such an interesting scene because there's so much going on in it. If you rewatch it over and over and over again, it's like one of these weird scenes where it's like everyone's just having a summer vacation day, laughing, playing, swimming, and you know what's about to happen and you see what's about to happen. And then when it does, it's as if time freezes. Everybody, the normal response is run, but I guess shock sets in for everyone and everyone just freezes. And then they run, and then they go to the water, and they're trying to pull everyone out. And it's such an interesting scene to watch.
Yeah, I really like the way they focused it on Brody's face when he saw it. Like, that was very good.
The glasses,
right?
Yeah.
Oh. Well, it showcases, right? So your brain sees something incredible. The reason why people pause is that their brain hasn't processed it yet. They don't know what they're seeing.
Yeah, in my scene.
I have to watch that scene a couple times. Even now, I still have to watch that scene because I go, where's the boy? Because it just, you see the fin and everything. And even in the beginning, I mean, when I watched it on my computer, I backed it up a couple times. I go, I've never really paid attention to that scene. And you're right. I really didn't know what I was watching. I had to watch it over, you know, a couple times, and maybe even freeze frame it slowly, because I really love my gore. So I have to play.
I think it's too, because you know what's going to happen. But you wonder, like, I was rewatching to see, was there any indicators to be like, well, come on, you guys got to see this coming. And there's not. Like, you really, it's as if, again, if you were on the beach, like, I, again, I'm terrified of the fact of that ever happening to me. So I think of that too. So I'm always in the water kind of looking, because you don't want to be that person when you look to your right and you see them just, and they're just oblivious to the water. And you're just like, turn around, look at the water, be aware, you know?
I wasn't that bad. We were swimming with all those seals and whatnot, and Sea of Cortez out of Baja. And we were snorkeling. It didn't really occur to me that there was great whites in that water, you know, and they love seals. And here we are. Oh, look at the seals. They're all cute. We're in the water with the seals. And I didn't even realize there was big sharks around there. And I get swimming around, you know, didn't even cross my
people
mind.
People paella to a shark.
Right. I mean, I have to say it's quite interesting, that beach segment as well, because Spielberg does his Alfred Hitchcock moment, his vertigo moment in that, which is, well, another thing is quite interesting at this time, that Spielberg was very good friends with George Lucas and Brian De Palma. They were very close
right.
in the studio here. So much so that if you weren't casting Carrie, you were casting Star Wars. You weren't casting Star Wars, you're casting Carrie. That's how close the relationship, you know, between Lucas and Brian De Palma was. And if you look at early Brian De Palma, it's all very much geared towards Alfred Hitchcock. Mm-hmm. Whether it's Carrie, Obsession, Sisters, so on and so forth. And it was quite interesting because Spielberg doesn't really do this ever again. But, you know, and I'm kind of wondering, like, how much was his influence? But, like, you know, his friends, you know, George and Brian goes, oh, this would be really good to put a, you know, Hitchcock moment in there. And he does capture it very good. But I have to say, this is probably the only time in a Spielberg film that he actually done something like that.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
it was very effective for me anyways.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. It was excellent. It really worked.
It also pushed the urgency, you know, for him running, having to run and run. And it's like you're like, you know, you want to run with them. Like, come on, let's get there.
And then the shark goes past his little boy after you see the other guy gets bit. His leg, like, sends down to the ocean, you know, and just bypasses him.
But what
I think I would have shit my pants by that kid. Oh, my God.
But what I have to say for Spielberg,
I think he did. So,
but what I have to say for Spielberg about that Alfred Hitchcock moment is probably the only time that it was used the most effectively.
Yes,
you see it a lot. You know, it's still imitated today, but that's probably I don't even think Alfred Hitchcock used it to as effectively as Spielberg used it in Jaws.
Agreed.
Right.
So, but. But yeah, I mean, I guess that will bring us to our final thoughts. So, John Hunt, do you want to start us off on our final thoughts of Jaws, the film, and the book?
Okay, so I think this is one of those rare instances, in my opinion, that the movie was a lot better than the book.
Agreed.
Absolutely.
So for me, you know, I saw the movie first, and then I read the book. And I remember the first time I read the book, because I read it recently, but the first time I read the book, I remember being really disappointed. But, you know, I was younger, right? So it's just like, but now when I read it again, I realized why I was disappointed. And it's because for me, I thought all that subplot with the affair and all, like, it wasn't necessary. And I think Spielberg made a great call on that, streamlining the motivations of the town people around it. And he utilized Brody's perspective to get across what was most important to the town, what they needed to do to safeguard the town's interests, and what pressure could be applied to affect that goal. So I just enjoyed Robert Shaw. Like, Quint in the book was...
magnificent.
Yeah, in the book he was very one-dimensional, but in the movie, like, amazing. Right?
Yeah, he scratches his hands down on the
Yeah.
It's like,
and Hooper in the book, I'm like, okay, this is like a self-entitled kid who's taking advantage of a situation because he can, not because he should. So, but in the book, it was like, you got this nerdy guy who really, really loves sharks, and he's so excited to be a part of this, and he's offering his advice, and he's helping Brody do the right thing. Like when they went to cut open that tiger shark, right? Like he's helping Brody do the right thing, and you know, for his own aims as well, because he wants to keep looking for this great white he knows is there. He wants to keep doing this, so it is you know, motivational on his part, but it also helps move the story along with Brody realizing that, you know what, we still have this issue to deal with. So for me, I just felt like the book fell flat in
I agree.
Realizing the characters, right? Because I did like Brody in the book, but he was to the point that he was lukewarm. He was just kind of there. He was kind of like the middle of the seesaw. So everyone else was like operating badly, but he's the guy in the middle that's just kind of keeping the status, right? So and that's how you judge the other people's behavior, was based upon his non-behavior. So for me, I thought the movie was hell of a lot better.
Right.
What about yourself, John Wilson? What are your thoughts?
I'm gonna have to definitely agree with John. You know, watching the film, I think if I had the perspective of reading the book first and then watching the film, it would have maybe been different for me. But like seeing that the movie was primarily about, you know, the villain was the shark and the relationship between the three men and how they were kind of going out there and really being, you know, Ahab, if you will, to go out to hunt down this shark, changes the whole perspective from the book, which is, you know, it is about the town. And so reading that secondary to the film, it was kind of like, well, this is interesting. And you see these relationships with these people and realizing there's what's under the surface of them versus what's under the surface of the water and the shark almost becomes secondary. And that was disappointing, you know, and I wanted more. And as Keith had said earlier, that when you get to the moments where the shark is and you see the visceralness of the shark, it actually, you want more. And then you're like, and we're back to the town people. Great. And you know, and you kind of have to just be patient and get through, you know, these moments. Whereas the film does a really good job at pacing. It paces the first attack and then what happens in the response to that. And then the second attack and then the response to that. And then, you know, then by the urgency of the third attack, it's like, we're going to go full force and go after this beast. So I definitely love the film much more. Again, I'm still very terrified of the water, but I guess I'm a sin and I will keep watching this movie over and over and over again.
Maybe you have to go on vacation together just for shits and giggles.
Yeah, I would love that. We should all go on vacation. It'll be a literary license podcast vacation.
We need to.
And what about South Victoria? What are your thoughts?
I've got to agree with the two boys on that. I read the book, and like John Wilson says, you have to be patient, especially in the second part of the book. I really thought that the second part of the book's like, what the hell is this? You know, it's like, okay, I understand the three parts, but then they go into the second part. And when you're reading the book, especially if you've seen the movie first, it's like, where's the shark? And, you know, when you get to the movie, and I have to say, I have to agree with both of these guys, that the movie was definitely much better than the book. And like how the actors play off each other, the three guys, you know, going off on their fishing expedition there, and how they have the one main thing that they want to do together is to kill this shark, because they all have an axe to grind with it. You know, Quint, because I think he hates sharks because of what happened with the Indianapolis. Brody, because he wants to protect everybody. And then Hooper, he just wants to, you know, study, you know, sharks and whatnot. He knows it's a horrendous predator and it has to go. But I have to say that the book, although it was easy to read and I could interact with characters in it, I got everything that was going on and it was, you know, pretty fluid. You can't top the movie. The movie was just fantastic, and it's going to be anybody, no matter what age or, you know, what generation, it's just always going to be one of those epic things you just have to watch. It just resonates into each generation. I think everybody likes watching Jaws. My 5-year-old grandson loves it. My daughter yells at me, however, for letting him watch such things, but he thinks it's cool. You know, it's not like there's a shark that's going to come up and get them, sort of like zombies. And the big tremor worms and stuff that we were watching this morning.
And myself, I'm going to be slightly controversial here because the thing is, I'm not a great fan of the book, but I'm not a great fan of the film either.
No.
There's some reasons behind this. I do think that what I did like about the book, I love the small town politics, and that's what for me made the book interesting. And as far as the shark is concerned, you know, I think that when you have this cast of characters and you have a shark that's being written as living in its natural habitat, just doing what a shark does, and that becomes the most interesting character in the book without any pretense whatsoever. I think sometimes that's where a book can falter a little bit, you know, mm-hmm. but I did like the small town politics and everything like that. As far as the film Jaws is concerned, what I did find strange about the film and the book is that when I was reading the book, and I've seen the film quite a few times, when I was reading the book, I did not place any of those actors or saw any of those actors in the book whatsoever, which I thought was quite interesting because normally it's like, you know, you read something and you see the actor in that role.
Right.
But so as far as the book as Jaws is concerned, you know, I enjoyed the small town politics of it all. I enjoyed the shark attacks, but I didn't really have a lot of empathy for anyone in the book, but I did enjoy that part of it. As far as the film Jaws is concerned, my problems with the book of Jaws that if you take Robert Shaw out of the film and you put any other actor in that role, you're not going to have that actor. You're not going to have that role.
Right.
He made it.
Right.
And I found that the film was very, very kind of flattish. You know, you kind of have like shark attack, shark attack, shark attack. Business, and then the final finale. And I think Robert Dreyfuss is good. I think Rob Schrider's good. But they didn't really capture my eye. Only one actor captures my eye, and so that's why I always have a problem with Jaws. I just find that if Robert Shaw wasn't in that film, I would not like the film whatsoever.
He did make it.
Absolutely.
And I just found that as far as the shark is concerned, I really had difficulty with films like this anyway, where it's like man encroaches on an animal's habitat, and all of a sudden it's like, oh, we need to kill it. You know, it's
right.
like a lion maims someone in the zoo, let's kill the lion. You're like, what the hell are you doing in the fucking cage to begin with?
So exactly.
And I think that has, you know, but when I was younger, I did enjoy Jaws a lot more. I think now that I've gotten older, I'm just becoming old and cantankerous.
Jaded. So, but I think in the movie though, their initial response wasn't to kill the shark. Like they were told to close the beach so the shark would go away. Yeah. Right. So, but the problem arose in that movie or in the book itself is when they refused to close the beaches and they kept that shark's food source there. And then came the motivation for revenge on a thing that had no real reason other than to eat, right? To do what it did. You can't take revenge on something that doesn't really exist, right?
Yeah.
So, but I mean, overall, I mean, I think I like the movie slightly more than the book if I had to compare the two. So,
but the small town politics were more interesting in the book.
Yeah, I found the small town politics. I always found, you know, and it's a bit like in most Stephen King stuff that I read. I mean, I'm not a big fan of later Stephen King. I'm more of a fan of the early stuff. And I think it's because in the early stuff, I'm more interested in the town and the small townspeople and what's going on. I always found that more interesting than what the main characters were going through. So,
yeah.
But it's, I mean, at the end of the day, it's just personal preference. You know.
Yeah, because I love Stephen King. Duma Key is amazing. Have you read Duma Key?
Yeah, that was really good.
And Lizzie's story, that was awesome. Mm-hmm. I really like those. So, but yeah, I know what you mean.
But even like in, what is it? Not Finders Keepers. What was it? Needful Things. When it's all about people in Castle Rock. You know, like the main character. I mean, the book is not an excellent book, but it's all the townspeople in Castle Rock.
Well, it's like Dolores Claiborne.
The characters are amazing.
Claiborne's a great one.
Yeah, the characters in that were amazing. They were all interesting. All their motivations for going there were different. It was so good. I thought that I enjoyed that book, actually.
But even in Salem's Lot, I mean, the best characters in Salem's Lot is not the main character, it's everyone else. And
absolutely.
I love that book. I love it.
And that's what, you know, so that's what I liked about Jaws. I liked all the, you know, the behind the scenes, the politics and everything that's going on there.
And then, then we get into soap opera territory, and then we get
right to
horror film territory in the last 30.
As the waves roll.
Yeah. As the fin rolls, as the rubber wrap rolls.
So that brings us to the end of this episode of Literary License Podcast, discussing Jaws by Peter Benchley and Jaws directed by Steven Spielberg. So, John, do you want to close out our show for us?
Yes, a special thank you to our guest, John Hunt, for joining us. You can find out more about John if you head on over to his website at johnhuntfiction.wordpress.com. As all of our Literary License listeners head out to enjoy the sun, make sure to put on your sunblock, strap on the floaties, and tread the deep ocean lightly, because you never know what lies beneath. But it's a good thing that you do know to head on over to our website at llpodcast.com to find all of our social and podcast platforms, as well as check out our past episodes, become a patron, and read our reviews of books to screens and everything in between. And if you didn't know, now you know. So make sure to tune into our podcast, our next podcast, which continues to follow our theme this month of Born with Teeth, where we'll be covering the two films, 30 Days of Night and Near Dark. Thank you all for downloading, sharing, and liking the Literary License Podcast. Until next time, just keep swimming, swimming, swimming. Bye, guys.
Bye.
Bye.
You heard him. Slow ahead.
Slow ahead.
I can go slow ahead. Come on down and chum some of this shit.
You're gonna need a bigger boat.
Maybe there's a shark in
Okay.